Good morning, everyone, and once again, welcome to this electronic act of worship. I've just had a look back and realised this is the eighth week in a row that we've not been able to worship physically in our church buildings and have been worshipping digitally instead, which I think at once it seems like a long time, and at once I think it seems to have gone very, very quickly. I think the situation is going to carry on. We are expecting an announcement by the Prime Minister this evening, but it seems that any changes to the conditions of the lockdown will be very gradual and slow. So I think we are going to have to endure in the current situation for a little bit longer. Big thanks to John Aldershaw. Many of you know John is a retired United Reform minister living here in Wirral and worshipping at St George's. So thank you to John, who's contributed and shaped this service, and we will be hearing his reflections in a little while. While we're on the notices, as it were, it is this coming week Christian Aid Week. Now, of course, normally we'd be involved in helping to raise money for Christian Aid in different ways, perhaps through the door-to-door collections, perhaps through other events, which of course isn't going to be possible this week. But the work of Christian Aid is still needed. There are still, of course, many people living in poverty around the world, people coping with the effects of natural disasters. So if you are in a position to and you are able to contribute something for the work of Christian Aid, then please do consider making a donation this week. Because, as I say, their work is still very, very much needed. And we will be thinking in our worship next week, we'll be thinking a little bit more about the work of Christian Aid across the world. But we begin our service this morning with some words from Psalm 31. In you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. Now let us pray. Dear Lord, as we worship in your name, listen to us and bring us peace. Be with us in our homes to protect and support us. Be our rock and our refuge, that we may be made strong. Let your face shine upon us, that we may show your love. We thank you as always for your enduring grace. May your truth fill us with wisdom to see your presence in all that we do. Fill our homes with your Spirit, so that we may receive new life, that we may serve you in all that we are. And we say the words of the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Our first reading is from the first letter of Peter, chapter 2, starting at verse 2. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you then who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvellous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." Amen.
Well, good morning. We know that the church is the gathering of people, the living stones built into a spiritual house, as Peter puts it in his letter. But we also refer to the building, the bricks and stones as the church, the place that we go to, rather than the being that we are together. Now we cannot go to the building, and so we are doubly reminded that it is us, gathered in this virtual way, that are the church. Oddly, we do not gather in one place, nor share this worship at the same time. But still we are gathered as the living stones to be a holy priesthood. Within a building, particularly in an archway or entrance, there is the keystone that holds the tension and keeps the structure together. Or a cornerstone, which again is the vital part of the building. Peter's letter reminds us that it is Jesus who plays this role in our spiritual church gathering. Without him, the structure becomes dangerous and collapses. So, for today, as we gather in this electronic way, and more in isolation than physical fellowship, we still come to worship in a spiritual togetherness focused on Jesus. For once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. So let us pray. And in this prayer, there's opportunity for a response if you'd like to join in. After the words, "We are precious stones working together," the response is, "Let us build God's kingdom. Let us build God's kingdom." So we pray. We come with joy in our hearts to pray and to praise. We are precious stones working together. Let us build God's kingdom. We come together to share in the gifts of God's Spirit, for we are precious stones working together. Let us build God's kingdom. Living God, you are the cornerstone rejected by the world. And we come to say sorry for those times when we have also rejected. But still, we are precious stones working together. Let us build God's kingdom. You call us to be a holy people. And so we ask for new possibilities in this strange time to share your word. We are precious stones working together. Let us build God's kingdom. Amen.
Our second reading comes from John's Gospel, chapter 14, starting at verse 1. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and, in fact, will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. Amen.
We know that it is true that we are the church, but we still look to places and buildings for spiritual support and identity. There are places of pilgrimage and buildings where we feel at home, and where the very stones seem to have absorbed within them centuries of prayer. There are buildings which are a solid reminder and witness to neighbours of our faith community. Now, in this time of crisis, the buildings have locked doors and we are forbidden from entering and from gathering or travelling to special or pilgrim places. So I have an idea for you. Leslie Weatherhead, one time minister of the City Temple in London, wrote a book a private house of prayer. The ideas in it can be adapted to our situation some 50 years later. We are in lockdown, and our home has become our world. In the private house of prayer, we can move around our house and in different places engage in varieties of prayer, using our own words or taking a book of prayers around with us, or using the notes which are attached to the invitation to watch this service. We begin in the entrance lobby or hallway. The number on the front door identifies the house, and the colour scheme, pictures on the wall and choice of carpet tells us something about whose house it is, who we are. In our house of prayer, here we acknowledge God's presence. It is his house as well as ours. He is with us. We affirm the presence of the inescapable God and rejoice. From here, we move to the living room. There may be photographs of family and friends, some books, our favourite chair. This is the place for adoration, praise and thanksgiving. A count your blessings room. I suppose the most private place in your house is the bathroom. It is the place where there are mirrors and where we are literally unclothed. It is a place to acknowledge who we really are. The selves that only we and God knows. So it is a place for confession. Acknowledge those things not done, regrets and lost possibilities. We can offer them to God. No one else can hear. And then there is water. We can wash our hands. Lots of that's been going on. And in that action, accept God's forgiveness and renewal. It is a reminder too of baptism, being bound together in the fellowship of the church. Now, clean and renewed, deep breath, open the door. The next room could be the bedroom, a place where you feel safe, snuggle up in the duvet, a place where there is security. This is the place where you could say that the Lord is my shepherd, and remember what God has done for you, just as you are. And then this can lead on to prayers for yourself, the things that worry you about yourself. Maybe you're upstairs now, so go into a different room and look out of the window, the world outside, which may seem to be a scary place now. Bring your prayers of intercession to God, for the neighbours whose houses you can see, and then what is beyond. Look as far as you can into the distance. See the sky. There may be, even today, a plane going somewhere. And what sounds can you hear? Bring it all together in prayers for the world. And finally, do you have an office space or a conservatory? A place where you can sit and think, maybe use visions, other Bible reading notes, or a book you enjoy. This is the time to let your mind roll on. Meditation and relaxation. And now go to the kitchen. Make a tea or coffee. It's fellowship time. So ring or email a friend. You're not an isolate on your own, but part of a fellowship, one of the many living stones that make up the church. Let us build God's kingdom.
Loving and gracious God, we come again before you in prayer. We pray for our homes. We give thanks for the places where we live and all that they mean to us. We pray for the homes of those that we know, of our friends and family, and people across the world living in many different circumstances. We pray too for those for whom home is not a place of safety. And we remember in our prayers those who are homeless, who do not have a place to call their own. As we await news and new announcements, we pray for leaders, for politicians, for scientists, for all of those faced with difficult decisions, with huge consequences, and we pray that they will act with integrity and humility. In a world in which there is warfare and violence, a world in which many grieve for loved ones who have died, we pray that those who are grieving will know your strength and peace, and that you will be for them a rock and a stronghold. In a world where harvests may fail, where supply chains are disrupted, where there are droughts and floods, We know that many do not have the money to pay for food and power. Many people are struggling to get by. We pray that these people may know your strength and peace, loving God. In a world where many people are alone and isolated, and where many do not know where they can look for comfort and encouragement, many people see no purpose or future. We pray for your gifts of companionship and support to be where they are needed. In our own lives, when we struggle and doubt, when we don't know what to do or where to go, when life feels overwhelming, we turn to you, loving God. We pray that we will know your strength and peace, and that you will be for us our rock and stronghold. We pray once again for everyone affected by the epidemic in different ways. We pray for those who are mourning loved ones. We pray for those who are sick at home or in hospital. We pray for people whose lives are disrupted, for businesses with no income, for people who have lost their jobs. And Lord, we look ahead to a time when things will change. And we pray for all of those who are helping others. People running errands and doing shopping for friends, doctors and nurses, care workers in homes, and everyone who is working hard to safeguard us all. And we ask all of these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Saviour. Amen. So we come to the end of our worship this morning. Thank you again to John for contributing that very interesting reflection. And we're going to finish, as always, with a blessing, but this week with a very unusual and very special blessing. This is something which is called the UK blessing. It's an amazing piece of work. It takes the words of the Aaronic blessing, the Lord bless you and keep you. They've been recorded by many different people in different churches right across the UK and been digitally put together so that many various people from many different churches, although physically apart, are singing these words together. It's absolutely beautiful. So I hope that you enjoy watching that, and that's how we're going to close our service. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord lift up his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and bring you peace. Amen.
Ah. his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you
and give you peace.
Amen. 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 Amen.
We pray a blessing. Manna rained down from heaven. This isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you.